go. Hi, 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 hi. I don't know. I have to say I'm not doing this very frequently, so I'm still trying to figure out how to control OBS. And I wish the camera would be working, but it's not, which is horrible. So welcome everybody. Hey BM, can you hear me okay? Is the sound okay? So if so, then give me a shout out in the chat. I'm trying to read it here, and let's see how this goes. So will you save this live? Yeah, I will. Yeah, I'm very likely going to save this. So I had like a live stream a year ago, or maybe even longer. And it's also still available on the YouTube channel, so you can see it there. Sound is fine, excellent. So, so to scare you a little bit, I can change this view. Hi there, that's me. But for some reason, OBS doesn't want to show this nicely. Oh, maybe I should turn on display capture here, so you can see, actually see something. And maybe I will try once again to get this. Like, why? What's like wrong with this thing here? Scene transition. It should. Why is that? Why is that? Let's compare the settings here quickly. Sorry about the delay. So it is active. It is configured. It is there. It has the view format. It matches the view format. It's audio detect. And it's audio capture only. And sometimes I just don't understand. Maybe it has to be some kind of like, okay, previous enabled, log preview, previous scaling, add, maybe some kind of video projector screenshot, transform, edit transform, maybe we fit the screen? No, still invisible. Okay, sorry about this. So I guess no video for today. Let's make it next time. So if the but I think you should see tool now, which is the most important thing. So what I thought we would do today is like I thought once in a while I'm in a coding frenzy, and I think most people think that coding is like super hard, and sometimes it is hard, but sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's just doing little small little fixes. And I thought like on a regular basis I try to actually build stuff and explain a little bit what I'm doing, and maybe you can ask questions or like give some pointers of what you actually want to see or what's interesting to you, and ask questions, and I will just explain what I'm doing. And I think I will start by writing a couple of ops, so operators. And so yes, this is tool. This is a default view, and in the background, if I switch this here, I have Rider. Rider is something like Visual Studio, just from JetBrains. And I prefer Rider because it has better code completion and has a lot of smart little things that help me to write better code. So for instance, bundle, you see like all this like little nitpicky things where it says like, well, you can write this here, but you can use like a new .NET feature to do it differently. So anyways, if the text is too small or the quality is not good enough, tell me in the chat. Otherwise, I will start by thinking about, so we had a live act recently, so maybe I can quickly show like how this looks like. So like my wife Lena and I, we do live visuals. And we have something bank on your visual.com. So this is our little website here, and we do like Lena does the music, I do the visuals, and we had a couple of acts last week. That's why I was also a little bit busy. And during this live sets, I noticed that our MIDI controller setup is not good enough. And so this is something we can improve easily. So what I maybe to show a little bit how this currently works is we can take a blob and oh, I really have to I have to you are seeing some live code here, which is not good. And I will quickly revert this here. Good. So let me quickly revert this. This was a test how maybe I will dash this. So I will just like brabble along. And if you ask any questions, ask the questions in the chat. So I'm using fork. And of course, we are using Git. And for instance, like here, I did something. So currently, there is a bug that if you have the content behind the graph, then you can't double click to open a graph. And this is a little bit, it's dirty and needs to be fixed eventually. And the best fix for this is to have like a better parameter window in the component view, in the graph view. And this is my attempt to do this, but I will continue this later. So I will use a Git feature called stashing. And here I can go stash and save this for later as a local copy. I save this as feed for feature and graph parameter window. Zack. And then all the local, these local changes are gone. And the good thing is that I had to restart tool. And I brought a bunch of MIDI controllers that I can connect. And then we can play a little bit MIDI. And then I can show it to you what we want to do. So, and actually, we can also connect the space mouse because the space mouse is also quick. So, should be a cable here. And yeah, I know that MIDI is probably outdated and it has a lot of like problems. But it just works still pretty well. So maybe quickly change here the camera layout again, the scene. So camera capture. So yeah, this is my MIDI controller. You see like a small hand labels for like the scenes I'm triggering. And I also have like a bunch of other MIDI controllers, but you just plug it in. Once it's plugged in and you start tool, it will be automatically detected and it should just work out of the box. So tool is come loading, loading, loading. Maybe we shouldn't have started this in debug mode. So okay, there we are again. So let's again create a blob and then we can take any of like these parameters that have one parameter, let's say the feather here, we drag this out and we do a MIDI input. And by default, this teach trigger here is active, which means tool is now waiting for a MIDI controller to be picked up. And if I move a slider here, then we see like, okay, now we have MIDI. We see that it's damped heavily. For me, otherwise, if we turn off this damping zero, then we see how, if we pause this here, you see that like how this is like have steps and it looks horrible if you actually look here on this thing here. So if I okay, maybe you can't really see it there, but maybe if we drag this off and drag it to the, let's say the round thing here and turn down the feather, you can, I'm not sure like how this is like getting, or maybe we use something even worse. Let's take the rotate. And let's change the output range from 0 to 360 of this MIDI controller. And then maybe we change the size so we actually see some rotation. And then you can really see like I'm moving this very, very slowly and you see the steps and it looks horrible. And if we go back to the MIDI input, maybe pin this here. So we can click here to return this and then it looks much smoother. But then of course the latency is increased. So it's always a trade-off. So anyways, what I wanted to do is, so during the live set, it's like really hard to see what's going on in this MIDI input. And I wanted to change the display of this thing here to look more like an LFO. So with the LFO, we have like all this little, like, you know, we see the current value, we see the value range. We can have like this thing if you hold control that we change the curve here, the length of the curve. And so I think this would be a nice exercise to actually look at an operator, see what it's doing and how we build this. And it should be straightforward. So you don't have to do MIDI learn. Well, you learn MIDI. So like learning MIDI is basically you press the teach trigger here and then you press like any of these controllers and then it will learn. You just taught that you taught tool that the MIDI device is this APC mini and we have the channel in the control. And this is how you learn it. And this will be these are all parameters that if you save this dashboard and if you would restart this again, it would all be assigned to your project. And we have like super complicated setups with the wake setups, you know, like we have like tons of MIDI controllers and all of them are assigned. So let's quickly watch like what's going on here. So why does this LFO ramp looks different than the MIDI input? The reason for this is, so how it's implemented, let's quickly close all like these previous nodes, we don't need them here. And if we look at the MIDI input here, MIDI input. So this is the code for like the MIDI input controller. It has, you know, and then here some stuff is even collapsed. So it is 300 lines of code. It looks quite intimidating, but you know, the MIDI input stuff is a little bit more complex because it has its own state and it has all this teaching thing and so on. But whenever you open a parameter, an operator, you see always the same thing. It has an ID. It's derived from like this instance here. So instance is a special type of it's an instance of a symbol and like this is like the real thing of an operator, you can say. So an operator, it's an instance of an operator that has its own state. And then you see it has these outputs and these are like, these are like these guys here. So result and somewhere here we have the result and we have the range and we have the range. And we see that this is all strongly typed. So this is all C sharp. And we see there's a slot here. And the slot is of type float. So this whole the slot thing does all the thing with like state evaluation and so on. And this one only gives back a float. So if we assign this here, so we see that this gives back this value here, like this. Yeah, this gives back this value, the float value. So we should use the MIDI input. So this would, which one did I do? No, this one gives back a float value. But we also have another one here. So this gives back a list, which might be sometimes interesting because you can do things like, let's say if you have your piano and then you have a range of controls, so every key on the piano is one little control and each, like I think the values of these inputs are the velocity you hit the keys with. So you get like a list of all these controls if you want them to. So sometimes it's also nice for syncing to doing stuff, sync to MIDI keys. So then let's go back. So we have all these parameters here and we have an update here. This update is being called with the evaluation context. I recently added a little bit of documentation on the in the wiki to that. So, so if you go to the wiki, I like wrote like a long little chapter of like how like this whole how how this graph is being evaluated. I don't want to go through this right now because it's rather complex and then we can't get encoding done. But anyways, like this function is being called. It does like gets like all these parameters and eventually it will set its final values here. So result.value and then we have like the damped output value. So we want to add some display for that. So the reason why the LFO, it's a similar type of operator, it's way shorter. It's only like half the size, and most of this is basically defining all these parameters. So most of the time, writing operators is not so complicated. But this guy has been assigned a custom view, and we want to do the same for the MIDI thing. So let's see how this works. So like this is an LFO, and I think we don't have to do anything. So there should be let's see. So like the LFO is being there are four times it is being used. Let's check where it's being used. And there we have like UI model in it, and I think this is what we want. So there is when to starts, there's a model that has all the things that have like custom UI components. See like all like this. So the counter, the GPU measure, the sample gradient, and so on. These are all operators that have like a special treatment. And so we do the same thing now for the MIDI input. So we just insert it here. Duplicate this line, we go to the MIDI input, we get this thing here. Maybe we do this side by side so we see a little bit more what's going on. So, and so this guy is this guy. In this namespace, we have a MIDI input. Precisely, the type is MIDI input. Put UI, this is the class we have to write, and then we have to draw child, we have to call this method in there, or basically we are not calling it, but we are saving this function pointer to this. So let's go to the implementation of this guy here, and if we look at the code, so let's go to this code. So we have an LFO UI, and I think we just duplicate this here. Wait, more doesn't add new class interface. MIDI input UI. Yes, we added two. And then we basically rename this to MIDI input UI. So that's like, then of course, everything related to LFO is now a MIDI input. And then we need to import this class. We don't need the LFO namespace anymore. We want to maybe get rid of like everything we did so far, so, which was a lot, which I just noticed. So let's comment this out. Let's comment this out, whatever this all is. And I think, so like what, let's move this over here again. This again. So we are here. So what this code does is every time we draw an instance of the MIDI input operator on the graph, this method is being called. And it gives us the instance of this MIDI input, something called a draw list, which is important if you're using IMGUI, and like an IMGUI rectangle with the rect on the screen. And so what we can do with this is we can use the draw list. Let's just to verify that this thing actually works. Add let's say add a circle, and the circle is the center is maybe like this green rect. This is center here, and the radius maybe like 200 pixel, and we use color dot green. Let's see what works. What happens if we stop this thing here? Yes, we cancel it. And then we check if if we can compile. Hi map. Hi Ahmed. Is tool intended to be a FOSS alternative to Touch Designer? I don't know what FOSS means, but achso, free open source software, I guess. I don't know. I think like I think it might have a similar target audience, but you shouldn't forget that like Touch Designer is huge, you know, like they are, and they are coming from Side Effects, which is even huger. So so they really know what they're doing. So it will be a long way to get there. Right now, I would say it's a very nice project to do visuals with. And I guess it's probably the focus will be closer to VJing. Oh, I don't know. We have some thunderstorms here in Berlin. Maybe we should close the window. Okay. So anyways, so you see, we wrote a couple of lines of code and we see that we have like this is our op here. And like we now have like something strange going on our graph, which is the red, the green circle we are drawing for this MIDI input. We also see that we no longer see that this is actually a MIDI input because we are not drawing this title anymore. And so I think this is a good start. So let's do some MIDI programming. Sadly, most of the time if you write operators, you don't have to restart tool. But this is not really part of the operator, but of the UI. So we have to keep restarting. This is horrible, but it is what it is. So what I thought what would be nice is to print like a little bit of information of what we are actually, so what's like the device this thing is attached to and the control, because this is what I was missing in the live show. And so we are using imgui.net, which has a super nice API, which means we get like all the code completion things here. And so maybe we can check what like this, all these other things did. So we have basically did it use the value labels graph? Did it actually use the imgui invisible button? Yeah, it used this thing here. Okay, graph rect, and the graph rect is expand minus 3. So okay, what we do is, so we get like this green rect, and we can use imgui text to or text. I think it should be text unformatted. Yes, and then we can use all the properties of this. This is. We should probably rename this to MIDI input. So this is our instance, and we use the MIDI input, and then we have our, there should be a device here, and the value is the name of our train device. I guess we should have like a fallback, so if this is zero, we should probably set something, maybe like set undefined or so, so this is C-sharp statement. So if this is null, it will use this but not cause an error. Then we have to say where this is being printed. So we say imgui set, there's something called a cursor position. Set cursor pose. Set cursor, there should be a screen pose, and we use our screen rect, and we use the top left corner of this. And maybe we also say this is we push with a small fonts.small. So imgui uses something called like a state. And on the state, it's very similar to this render context. So you can push something on the state, which is like everything from here on is being small. But then once you are completed with what you want to do is you have to actually pop this again from the state. So we pop this font and then to take it away, we don't have to say what we are going to take away. So I think we would also want to see maybe like the channel, and maybe we can write the channel behind this. Maybe we introduce a variable here, replace to, and we say this is the device title. Channel title. Okay, channel label is probably a better name. Label is MIDI input channel. Oh, it should be the control. I'm still confused with MIDI. Is the control or the channel? I think it's the channel. So this is an int, so it can't be undefined. It will always be like zero. So we can say if. So what I want to do is basically have something like an output saying, "Hey, is your this thing is called to your IPC mini?" And then maybe have like channel 32 or something. It's because so this is separated from colon, but I only want like the channel thing if there is actually a device. So what we do here is saying that let's say we have like the label, and the label is undefined. And then if string is null or empty MIDI input device value. If it is not the case, then we say the label is no longer undefined, but it is actually this guy here. And then we just concatenate this with the MIDI input device channel. Oh, not channel. Like so. And then we print it. I think this should work. Label. Okay, let's see what happens. Let's print this. Let's look at the chat. I think there's both. Hello. I think there's both. Both. I just discovered so EDK. What does EDK mean? IDK? Development Kit, maybe? So, okay. So here's our MIDI thing, and we see that we did something horrible. So what happens here? So it does the IPC mini. It detects this. So if we remove this here, and if we, and it's undefined precisely, and maybe we should call this undefined MIDI device. And if we teach it, then it says IPC mini, but it prints the type of the channel, which is an int, int 32, but it doesn't print its value. So we can change this easily. We say this is value. Okay, maybe we should call this undefined MIDI device. Maybe call it MIDI device? Question mark. So make not don't make it too long. Something like this. So this works. So the next thing I wanted to have is like a visualization of like what's actually coming from this MIDI device. And so I thought it would be nice to have a graphical representation of like the input and output range and of what's the current value for that. And to do this, I can remove this. Does it make? Let's just draw a rectangle there. And we can use the drawList.addRectFilled. And we use the, maybe we create a new, so like this rectangle is like the whole operator, but we want to have some padding, so we can use bar, we call this graph rect, and this will be this green rect, and we can expand this, and if we expand this with like a negative number, or maybe we first have to copy it. Graph, maybe this is some explicit thing. Expand in a 3, yeah, like so. Does it return a value? No. So this will now add like a 3, I think it will add like 3 pixel padding on each side. And then we can maybe check if this graph rect is has some size. Punkt get height is bigger than 0 and graph rect get width is bigger than 0. And then we draw our rectangle here. And this rectangle can. Do we want to have like a slider? We could actually do like an arc, like a pie chart. But maybe just an orange line would be better. So we draw a single line. You have to get like an X position, and the X position is like the, it goes from the, from our graph position. Why is there not a lab here? FF. Why? So, and we take the graph rect and we use the min dot x and the graph rect and the max dot x. And we lerp this, so we need like a normalized value. Like a normalized value, I call something that goes from 0 to 1. And the normalized value, we can take the min range, midi input, range dot. So we have like the midi range. And this goes from if we look this the media range is like the point value. It's a list of float. This is an output. Media input. What do we have? This is the range, the result. Device damping control channel. Control range. I think this is what we want. And the control range is like the. No, it's still not what we want. We want the output range. This is what we want. So the output range goes from that it defines. The value range that we can generate from this MIDI controller. This is what we changed earlier from 0 to 360 to have like a full degree, a full rotation in degrees. And so we take this, we take the value and we take the I think this goes from, this is the max. Max range is the Y. Range, let's call this width, is the max range minus min range. And then we can take the current value. Value should be the MIDI input Current MIDI value. I think this is, I guess, probably the default output. Where's the output slot? Slot the result. And this is also like a value. And then we want to normalize this. So that's why we normalized value is. Actually, you know that I think about this. This is stupid because there is. I think there should be something called like a remap function or so. Map utils. Yeah, a remap is much better. And we take our current value. It's much better. Sometimes it just takes a while. And we want to have like the min range and the max range. And we remap it from 0 to 1. This is what we want. Actually, we can do this even better. We don't remap it from 0 to 1, but to the range of where we want to draw our pixel line. Even better. Fuck. So, and wow, this is the x position of our line. Hui, this was complicated. And then we can draw our line. So this will be, I think this wants to have a vector 2. New vector 2. And this is the x position. And this is the graph rect min. So we want the top corner of our thing. And I think this wants to be a float. And I think this wants to be. Let's convert this into variable. Left pose. This we don't need anymore. And then the size of our rectangle should be the top left pose plus new vector 2. And let's make it 1 pixel wide and 10 pixel large. And then let's take a color here, color dot orange. Whew, this took us longer than I thought it would take. I'm so curious. Let's see what happens. So let's play this. So why do you have magic numbers? Magic numbers? You mean like the -3 and like this thing here? So it's an excellent question. So sometimes I think in the like this thing should go away, like the 10 people fix this, because of course we can use like our graphic range or graph rect height for that. I think the 1 is good enough for a magic number, and this, you are right, is actually horrible. I think we should fix this. Is a good idea. So let's make this let's call this padding, much better. And then here wider complains that this should be constant, which is correct. Okay, let's see what our thing here does. So we have a MIDI device. We haven't evaluated it. If you click the blob, we see no graph. Why don't we see a graph? This is horrible. There is our graph. So it goes. I think it does roughly what I thought it would do. So we see, like, if I have my slider at the middle, it shows me it's in the middle. If it's at the bottom, it's on the left corner. If it's to the far right, it's on the far right. I think I like this already. Maybe it's like a little bit too thin with 1 pixel. And then, of course, we need to change this to the whole width. And maybe it would also be nice to see the final output of this value. To figure out what it is. And also it would be nice, so right now if I rename this to something, let's say I want to say this is the rotation of, so then yes, I renamed it. So here is the custom name for this instance, but it doesn't show up here. So we want to have this there as well. And I think this should be possible somehow. I have to figure this out. Okay. So, and I think this looks wider, this one line here. This looks very thin and this looks like a little bit thicker. Are the rectangle values really pixel or can it be zoomed? No. So these are pixel values. This like all pixel values. This is like the thing with IMGUI that you are not using local coordinate systems and transform matrices, but you are actually you are working with pixels, which actually confused me when I started working with IMGUI. I think this was horrible because I was working with like another library like SAML WPF, which has of course all the fancy stuff like transform matrices, and you have like groups, and these groups can be scaled and rotated and so on. But I have to say, like after like a couple of months, I really started loving this because I think, you know, like why should this pixel get wider if I zoom in? You know, the resolution should increase, and the resolution does increase. You know, because it's like it's computed on the fly, so it should be, you know, it should be precise. But it doesn't make sense to increase the width of the thickness of this graph line. And so one side effect, sadly, is like right now, like it's not easy to scale fonts, which is, yeah, I think eventually we need to find a workaround for this. It's somewhere on my to-do list, but not very far. So, okay, let's clean this up a little bit. Let's take here like our graph rect. Let's get the height. And I think it would be nice to have the current value there as well. Yeah, maybe you can put the current value just below that. And oh no, wait a second. We wanted to have like the readable value there. So I think there are other operators that do that. I think the LFO should also do this. So let's see how they do this with the readable name. Readable, no, name. So we have the instance and we need the readable name of this instance. Maybe MIDI input dot. Is there like a name here? Parent. Oh, this is bad. Do I get the window shut there? No. Ooh. Okay. So this needs some work. Title gleich. So we have the MIDI input. We don't have to check it for null because we checked it up there. So this would not be defined. It wouldn't even go in there. So we want to have like the parent, which is the composition we are currently in. And here we want to have like all children, and we want to get one. And we want to get child where like the symbol child ID equals the MIDI instance symbol child ID. So this is now a symbol child here. And this symbol child should have a readable. No. We want to have a parent, children. This is. So where's this readable name coming in? Let's check if any of. So let's see if there's something like I was so sure that they had something before using the readable name. Hier, Symbol Child, readable name. Symbol Child, Instance, Parent, Symbol, Children. Ah, we need to have the Symbol Children there. Okay. So, here. Parent. symbol children. So, readable name. Okay. So this is super complicated. I will try to explain a little bit what's going on, but if you don't understand this, this is like completely justifiable. So the thing is, this is an instance of a symbol. So we have, you know, we have the symbol called MIDI instance, MIDI input, and this like the symbol defines which parameters the thing has, how it behaves, like all this code and so on. So an instance has like the parameters being filled. So the one instance could be, okay, you have an input on channel 2, and another MIDI input could be inputs coming from channel 3. So if we take the parent of this instance, this is the composition. So right, so V2 is no longer running, but if we start, this is probably the dashboard. Then the symbol of the dashboard is the definition of the dashboard with all the children, and one of these children is this MIDI input. And from all these children, we want to have like a single instance, and we want a single instance that matches our symbol child ID. And the symbol children, they have a property called readable name, and this contains the if this is, has been renamed. I know this is a mouthful, and you never need this until you do some very advanced operator programming. But now we have the renamed title. Should be like just one thing here, and then we can if not string is null or empty, rename title imgui text unformatted, rename title. And sometimes I have the thing I prefer to add quotation marks if something has been renamed. So I understand this easier. So let's add some quotation marks around this. So what this thing should do is it prints first, it prints like this, like this is a terrible variable named because this is a label. Let's rename this to device and channel. Zick. And then we print this thing here, and this is the renamed title. Okay, let's start this and read the question there. So, why do you think the rectangle values really pixel? Yeah, I think so too. It's all too small for my laptop screen. Oh, it's too small for your laptop screen. Should I, you mean like the actual font or like here in the stream? Then, of course, this I can increase. Isn't it better to create a vector2 outside the function? Outside the function? This I don't understand, Hamster? Hamster Hunter? Cute name. Is this a German accent? No, there is no German accent here. This is not a German accent. Some people said me I shouldn't emphasize this. So anyways, okay, we have this thing here. And it's not working because look at this. It's a renamed title here. Like this is like this is so bad. This is double bad. So this is what programming looks like. So we have like two bugs here at once. So I think if I'm probably removing this, it's even worse. It's even worse. So because of course this should not be printed if this title is not set. So this is the first bug here. Then of course it should actually use the label instead of printing like the variable name. And then, of course, we want it to be in our operator, not in the same line. But you see, if you want to, you could actually do some very funky stuff with your writing custom operator graphs. But most of the time, it's probably meaningful to contain its content to the operator. Okay, so we can quickly fix this. So this should, this needs like a formatting qualifier, I think it's called. So now this will be evaluated as a complete as a variable, and this should look now better. Then we need to use the set cursor screen position. We set the screen position, and I think there is something called a group that keeps the X position. I think it's called a group, begin group. And then it's super crucial that you always close what you begin and group. Okay, let's try this again. Cute bugs. So what's the resolution of your notebook if it's too small? Is it like 4K? So if it's 4K, then this definitely would be a problem. I think that Imgui does something with the screen DPI thing. So on loading, it will, so the font rendering, if you go into Windows, Imgui demo, so this is the full functional Imgui demo thing with a lot of playgrounds. It's not really related to tool, but it's nice for me to once in a while look at stuff. And one of the things in there is a configuration panel and a style. And in here, there's a font thing. This is all the fonts we registered. And I love this thing with the Atlas texture. And these are the fonts that are being generated on the fly when we start up tool. What I just don't understand is why this thing is squeezed. So it doesn't, like, all the icons look nice, but like the fonts look stretched somehow, but maybe that's the way. So I don't know enough about Imgui to understand this thing here. But I think this font atlas is being created every time you start up tool. And I think the size of the thing is arbitrary, so it could be, you know, like it does, it's like, I think it's using like the power of two sizes. But if the font size would just increase, like the texture would be, it would just jump to 1024 by 1024 or something. And so I think it should actually work, but I never tried it. It's something we have to. Okay, so it's rotation 2. You can rename it live. And if we actually evaluate it, we see our graph there. We see that something coming in. And actually, this is nice. Maybe it's also nice to see that something came in. And maybe it's also nice to see like this control. Maybe we want to channel in the control thing here. Now that I think about this, would also be nice. I wonder if there's like a if there's a convention how to write this. MIDI channel control. How do people write this? It's a C list? What the heck? The MIDI control change message. So there's a bank set. There's a pedal pen. Okay, maybe this is not what I want. So, okay, here is like an whatever, I don't know what beat bus block. So, but they have like channels here and devices, but they don't even show the control, which is also awkward. And here they have their channels. And the channels only go to 16. Oh dear, the MIDI stuff is like so confusing. I think I will just, maybe I will just add a suffix there, a prefix. So maybe people will figure it out. So we have the, we, maybe we can change this into like, we also take this into like a formatted string. We add a colon there. Close this thing, close this thing here, this is our colon, and then maybe I will just add device, device title is okay, and then I will add like a C for the channel. Oh, the control is the same thing. Then I will have a CH for channel, and another colon with MIDI input. Control. And maybe we don't need the colon there. So we make it like this. So this should be good enough for now. And I wonder if it's also interesting to see the. I think this should be good enough because it, like this solves my problem. Or at least the problem I had, so I wasn't really sure what was the training thing for my MIDI controllers and what if they're actually responding and so on. And this is good enough for me. So one last thing we could actually do is we can write the current value. So and it actually would be nice if the value fades out once it's triggered, so that we actually see if there's something new coming. This would be interesting. So let's first write a current value. So we to write a value, this should be straightforward. We just take the MIDI input and we take the result. The result is a float value. We use this for like the drawing the graph earlier. We use its value. Let's add some formatting here. So let's say we also, we only want like two values behind the comma. And then we could actually set the color here. And I wonder if there is like a time, does the MIDI input has something like a timing information? Timing MIDI event commun. There should be something like a time since last message received or so, because that would be useful. Train channel out, print. Controller height, new signal. So there's a new signal coming. So, okay, like this is a message receive handler, which is like asynchron. We don't want to mess with that. And on every frame, we use this. Close on this. We update the MIDI controller with the context and we check all the messages that we if we got one. And so this is where we lock, so we don't have any thread locks or so it needs to be thread saved, so that's why we lock it. And then we go through this and okay, this is if teaching has been active, this is what we don't care. And so maybe we can just add something like this. So let's add something like a time, a last message time. I think this would be great. And so we basically add public double last message time. And then every time we get a message, we set this. So teaching active for each signal. Oh, wait a second, this is, we actually, we have to check if this is from control range is active. controller value. Default value, I think. I think there is also some filtering going on. So if it's the right device and the right channel and the right, but I think the filtering is going on this a little bit lower. So let's add this here. Last message time equals context, and I think we just used a still like a playback. I thought there would be something like a grunt time or some playback timer bars. Let's take the time in seconds. I don't know if this is correct, but we should see something now. No, so far we don't see anything. Now we have to write, let's say we take a value that is one if we see a message, just saw a message, and zero if it's being faded out. So we call this update fade factor. We take the MIDI input. We take the last message received time. We subtract this from the, I think there should be something called a playback. Actually we want this runtime in seconds. We subtract these, and then if we divide these by, let's make it 5 seconds or so. And then we want to have like these two things, and we want to clamp this from 0 to 1. And now we want to have we remap this. Let's call this normalized fade out. Fade out. So we use our math utils, we remap this value, and normalize, this is the current value we are remapping, and the input range is 0 to 1, and the output range is, so if it's 0, it should be opaque, and if it's halfway faded out, it should be 0.5 or something like this. And we take a white color, faded color equals color dot white dot, should be a fade, and we can fade this out here. Maybe we have to fade it out as a float. And then we can use imgui. Or maybe there should, maybe there is a text unformatted. Maybe there's an overwritten with a color here. No. I thought there would be something with a color. Color text. Text. Text colored. I'm scared. So the problem with why I don't want to use this function is, so there is a problem that, we don't have this problem. So in GUI, there's something magic with like formatting. So if you use like double percentage signs, then it will do some really weird things with the formatting, which I didn't really understand. So that's why I'm always using this unformatted thing. But now we use the fade color, and we use our actual text message here, and maybe just we need to invert this, but let's see how this looks like. Okay, so let's hit the chat. Draw list, adrect fill, are you creating a new vector? In draw list. You mean like this thing here. Draw list, add vector fill, where was it? You mean this guy. I think this is a personal preference. For me, this is still fine. So it's also, I think sometimes it'd be fine to, so if this is, does do some really crazy stuff like computing a lot, then I start like wrapping it, so like here, so into multiple lines. So I like, if for very long to code lines, I don't like this, but for me, introducing a variable there would be too much of an overhead, because then you would to think about a name for this variable, and I personally don't, I'm not convinced that would improve code readability. So I think for this is just fine. I tried to change the font, but I think it changes only the menus. But I will try again, make sure. Okay. Yeah, try this and tell me so if it works. So then. This showing the scene number being mapped. Yes, I hope it should work. This is to display MIDI control activity inside the operator. Precisely. Yeah, precisely. This is what we are trying to do. So I like what's going on here. Let's start this again. I don't know why this took so long. Okay, it's running. Why is it wrong? Is it starting on my secondary screen there? What's going on? Come on here. Okay, there we go. Okay, so we see it's working horribly, just like coding normally does. So, of course, our mapping was completely wrong. So, if I change this, pin this here, we see that it's showing the value. But it's not fading out at all, because we're using the runtime. But inside the operator, we should use the we didn't use the runtime, so we can change this on the fly, because this is an operator and this will be recompiled. So last message time should be not the context time, but playback runtime in seconds. And we can save this here, and this should be recompiled. Boo, boo. So, okay, we have to restart anyways. Let's start this again. Because if we recompile an operator, the linking between the custom UIs and the operators are being broken, so that's why it didn't really work. So startup takes so long. I believe we have to clean up. You have to find namespaces and clean up the. There are too many operators right now. So we see that it did fade out a little bit. So after 5 minutes, 5 seconds, it gets white. So it does something with the 5 seconds. Of course, we have to remove these quotation marks there. Maybe we clear this custom name so it looks a little bit simpler. Oh, interesting. The custom name is always MIDI input. Okay, we have to fix this as well. And then, oh, we didn't change the. I forgot to change the value there. So let's first. Here we want to have the value. Then here we don't need quotation marks. Step by step. No. Here we want to have the quotation marks, but not at the value. So then, what's happening here with the. So we are using the time. Actually, I think we should also add a small comment. Mini graph. Let's call this a mini graph. And maybe here we for this whole group thing, let's call this. Draw label and current value. Depending on how many times that method is being called, creating a variable of your vector outside method could actually be faster in terms of performance. Are you sure? I think this, I don't know. I got very, 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 very skeptical with assumptions like this. So when I was young, there was like some arguments. So there was this like maybe like talking about like programming once in a while. It's also nice. So let's say we have a for loop. For int e equals 0 and e equals and e plus plus. Oh, come on here. Some typing. So and we would do something in here in this for loop. So it's just for the sake of discussing something. And let's say you do this for loop very, very, very often. Very often. So maybe it's a ray tracer or something. And then like all the good developers, they were very bright in, like they made sure to write it like this. Because writing it like so does not create an implicit variable that is being incremented and passed back as a result. In practice, however, like to detect this is like the most simple thing a compiler can do to optimize performance. So if you write it like this, internally it will be like this. And for everything, so that for everything that is super easy at optimization stuff, the profiler will do this. So I would bet like hundreds of euros into that it will not make a performance difference if it's like inline or outline, because the profiler, the compiler will, this is a super simple optimization for C Sharp. So. But then again, the question is how often is this being called? This is being called once a frame for every MIDI instance we have. So how many MIDI input instances we have? Maybe like 10, 50. So yeah, this would be like, wouldn't even, yeah, it's not necessary to optimize this. One thing, however, that would actually be very important to optimize is like these guys here. So these will generate something called heap allocations, and we use C sharp, which means C sharp has something called like garbage collection, which is probably the one thing that is most awesome and the one thing that's most horrible about C sharp advanced. So there's always the trade-off. But yeah, if you do a lot of these, then once in a while you will get frame drops because all this garbage has to be freed. Most of the time it will not be that. And we have much worse scenarios where we actually generate a lot of heap allocation. But yeah, so watch out for like if you do like this kind of things, watch out for tons of allocations, because this will lead to frame drops. So anyways, let's check the set again. Since, yay, depending on how many, yeah, okay, we had this question. May I ask what a damping parameter does in the MIDI control? This is an excellent question. So is tool running? It's still running here. And so I think we fixed this. It should look better if we load it next time. So damping. I think damping is super important, and that's why we have the damp parameter here, and that's why we actually did a little bit more with the damp parameter, or at least I did, maybe like last week or so, because I was actually stumbling over this. So if we can read a little bit here, but this is like super small, so I'm not sure if this is legible on the stream, but we see that there is an example here, so we can drag in this example and we can look at this and maybe pin the output here. And what this does, let's quickly walk through that. So the time is running. Time, if I pause this, it stops, but right now the time is running. And we have like this LFO, it's a counter here. This counter generates a Perlin noise, so this is some random value. This is like this blue thing here, I think. Red. Oh, what is that? I think it's called, it should be the red value. Somewhere here, there's a red value. So here you see the red value. Yeah. So it's gen this is like, it's a random value coming from somewhere. And then there are different ways of like damping this value. You want to have like a compromise between like how rough are these steps and how, what's the latency. And so we let's regenerate this thing here. We have a value, we have this damp, and maybe we generate like a vector float 2 to vector 2. Let's pin this and let's. So now we have this vector here. Every time I go in here and change this value, oh, we wanted to pin this, sorry. Then we see like this one thing increases drastically. Does some really weird thing. And the other thing is like it's trying to get to reach this smoothly. Right now, the current interpolation is linear interpolation. This is the same thing the MIDI controller does. So this means basically that on every step, we use 95% of the last value and mix in 5% of the new value of the thing here. Actually, this thing is much cooler, the damped spring. So let's try this again. So the damped spring will, it will be much smoother because it will not have like crude little steps. It will always like have a small transition there. So if we decrease the damping here a little bit, if we decrease this a little bit, then the latency will be lower. But like if we have like this weird value that is like the red value is always like a nice smooth curve. And then of course we can find the compromise between like how like if we increase the damping even further, the spring damping, then so like the latency will be smaller, but it will still be like a really small curve. So okay, complete detour, but maybe interesting to see. Depending being called, creating the dynamic parameter, I'm pretty sure because you are creating a new vector. Yeah, the new vector, so the new vector the so in C sharp there's something there are two kinds of things you can create that are complex. Classes and structs. So the like this thing here is a struct. So I think if you hover over this here, we see that this is a struct. And there is no other way to generate any vector whatsoever besides new. So even if you do something like this, so if you have something like if you add two vectors or so, it will generate a new struct. And it's completely fine. So for the small data types, so having like thousands and millions of structs is just fine. So I think it should be okay. I also would be in doubt. Modern languages are quite good in avoiding memory fragmentation and such. Well, with memory fragmentation, yeah, I'm not sure about this, but most of the time, I think there is this. So the problem should not be to optimize code. I think the best approach for me at least is to get something running, just like I did. So I had like some huge plans like for like this MIDI input thing here. But then actually after I saw this, I think, okay, we have to cut this off there. We have to fix this definitely. So if we zoom out, it doesn't look like so strange here. But it's fine for me. But I learned this after like, getting it running. So like the first thing for me is like get something running and see how it's working. And then if it's super, super slow, then we can actually do something. And then there are like tons of like super nice profiling tools that tell you where it's slow and so on. So premature optimizing is the source of all evil, somebody said. Donald Knuth said it, but I think it's not true. Then amazing tool C sharp is the only option for writing code. Will C sharp be an option in some point, do you think? Garbage collection sucks for real time. Which is a valid statement. On the other hand, I would say for the real-time stuff, most of the stuff will actually be on a GPU. So where real-time is not really such a big issue. So right now, of course you can write. You can write like a C++ library and write a wrapper for this. So imgui is C. And we are using the C implementation with a C sharp wrapper. And there are tons of libraries that are, for instance, like all the MIDI thing, I think is also like C with a wrapper and audio. Or maybe it's not, I'm not sure. But we are using a bunch of like things that are C++. But for, let's say, 99% of the code that we wrote here is either HLSL, so it's on the like on a graphics card, DirectX, or it's like C sharp. And I personally, I have to admit, I love C sharp. It's a really nice compromise between actually getting something done, and for me, it's fast enough most of the time. Okay, let's clean this thing up and then write another operator. I noticed that I spent way too much time writing this thing here. So we wanted this be already fixed. We already fixed the quotation marks here. We wanted to change this, not readable name, but we wanted to have the name here. And only the name is the thing that is being renamed there. And there's the renamed title. And then we already removed the quotation marks there. I think I will clean up this thing later with the last message time. I think for some reason, the last message time divided by 5. Runtime in seconds minus last message time divided by 5. And we clamped this from 0. I still don't know why this is, why it jumps so suddenly. I have to figure out this later. But what one thing we definitely can do, we can add like something called a clipping region. So we in GUI push clip rect, we use our screen rect here. Min screen rect max. And we want to use clip after thing. And then before we end the group, then we pop the clip rect. And this will make sure that it never leaks out of our operator UI. Okay, but actually, we did some extra coding, which was nice. So the next thing I thought about was so either implementing OSC, which would be interesting, so instead of a MIDI input and OSC input, or writing new compute shader operators. So what do you want to see? It's a question to the people in the chat. So do we have an opinion? We can check this here. Yes, we see it's our channel 1, control 5. We change this. We rename this here. If we rename it, we should see the value. Yes. Okay. And we see the current value here. Okay. Nice. And if we move here, still a mistake. Still a mistake because we want the rename title. Is of course we want the value, we want to print all the time. Okay. OC sounds great to me, but I'm not picky. Computator. So it's 101, so we need a third opinion. OC would be more C sharp. Computator, of course, would be HLS, which would maybe would be interesting because we actually do something with visuals. So we actually see something and have a bunch of ideas that might be interesting and really easy to do. And yeah, computer sounds scary to a lot of people, but actually, once you do a little bit of it, it's not that bad. So maybe we can quickly, for the delay of the sprint, let's do commit here. So let's see what we've changed there. Or maybe we have some unused namespaces here. So we added the last message time, so we can actually log this. We added a MIDI input UI. We made a static. Oh, we have like uncommit. So one thing, like if you ever start writing with Twilio and contributing code, then one thing I hate is code that is being committed out without an explanation why this code is still there. So always look at your commits and see, ah, there's uncommitted code. We don't want that. So let's commit this, and then we added this thing here. I think this looks awesome. It's a little bit strange UI model. I think we introduced this line break here, which we don't need. Okay, and then we add custom UI for MIDI input, and we are on dev, and then we can just push it there. So let's go with CompuChair then. It's much better, and we don't have to compile so much stuff. So and it's also it might be interesting to some people because oh, wait a second, I got a message here. So a little user doco for a new operator. Perfect, perfect. Yes, there should be. So okay, let's give you like a small introduction of like a system we are using quite a bit, which is I call it the point structure. And if you have seen like a bunch of tutorial videos, it might have come up again already. So we have something called points. So G points is like haha, but G stands for GPU and stuff on the GPU, and we generate a grid by 10 by 10 pixels. Right now we can 10 by 10 by 10 points. Right now we don't do anything with these points. Eventually we should add some kind of output representation of how this buffer actually looks. Right now we don't, but we can draw this, pin it, and then we see our grids here. And the nice thing about the structure is that very versatile, and you can interesting things like, let's say, so it's GPU, so you can have a lot of points. It's very fast, so you can, you could actually connect these to like some inputs. So we could say, let's say I have my great MIDI input here. MIDI. Oh, wait a second. We first have to we have to cast it into an int, which is horrible. Okay, let's take a thing here. This is being mapped from 0 to 1, and let's map this to like 400. So every time I now use my MIDI controller, like this thing generates a buffer here. And with this, we can do interesting things like, for instance, add noise or so. And if we increase the resolution again, we suddenly have where's the face, and we have some kind of effect here. So one thing I wanted to do is to have to reduce these blocks to a certain area. So if you imagine that, so let's not add noise, but let's randomize these points. Randomize points. So, and if I randomize the position here, we see we get if we increase this value, we get like tons and tons of points. But maybe I want to have random points within a certain box. And this might be totally useful because we could use the camera position and fill the thing around the camera with these points, which might be interesting. So, and we generate a new operator for that. I guess there should be also a little, yeah. So we will start a new operator in a second. And it is how a tool could be used in games. To be honest, I don't think that building a game with tool would be quite a stretch. So you could do some interactive applications, but I guess it's meant to do something really well with, which is like motion graphics and maybe real-time animations for VJ stuff. So we are using Unity at work quite a bit, and I have a little bit of like played around with other engines, game engines, and there's like so much you need for a good game engine that even Blender, so, and the Blender team is really good. They had a game engine and they stopped supporting it. So yeah, I wouldn't recommend building a game with it. But with the Tool.io thing, we actually did a bunch of games for clients. So it is possible, and sometimes it might be nice, but this was all like super small interactive solutions for exhibitions. So don't, I wouldn't build a game for it or with it. So let's build a new let's build this operator. So we let's take this operator, and the best way to build a new operator is we duplicate it as a new type, and we tell it where to go in which namespace, lib point, GPU, so on, just right, and we call this 5 points. This is what the thing should do, and grabs points within boundary, within a boundary volume. The most complicated thing for me is like not writing ops, but writing these descriptions. Okay, so let's see what happens. So we have this is our new operator. And it works. So right now, so we can plug this in, and if things work, this should work. It does the same thing as randomized points, but it's a new operator. And if I save and open tool and go here into my wrap points, here is our new operator. So we just created. Don't have to write any C sharp code. One thing though that might be interesting here is because we duplicated the old operator, and we see the spaces thing here is not used. We see that a space here is now an integer, and what it's actually supposed to be is like a drop down list between point, space, object space, and word space. So let's change this quickly. Space. So we have this is called an attribute. We need this attribute to say this is the ID of this input, and this is an optional parameter called map type. We can say map type is type of spaces, and this is all we have to do. And now this is a nice drop-down list, so much better, much easier to read. So now if we jump into our operator, we see okay, this is 5 points. It has a small description there. We can later edit it if you want. But right now, we need to figure out what are the parameters of our new operator. And of course, we need to write a new shader there. And the easiest way for me to write this new shader is we click Edit, Visual Studio Code opens. So, here we go. And then we save this into a new file and call this randomize points. We call this wrap points. And just to check that it actually worked, let's comment out this code and save it. And then of course we have to load our new shader here. So let's do wrap points. Ooh. Okay. So obviously we have to write out the new result points is the source point without any changes. Okay, there we go. So right now we have an operator that does nothing. Hi Gil, hi Sense. Let's quickly look at this thing here, what's going on here. So on the left side, we have all the inputs. So if we select our wrap points, we see in the parameter view, points, amount, and so on. The nice thing is we have these numbers here, which means it's an indicator that you can actually change the order of these parameters by dragging them. So right now I think you have to reload it once so it works, but then it should work. We take this point buffer, we like a buffer. Okay, this is getting a little bit complicated, but in DirectX, a buffer is a data structure on a graphics card, and this graphics card needs a description of how to access this data structure. At least this is how I understood it. And this description, how to access it, is called a view a shader resource view. And sometimes you can generate like new shader resource views for resources, but this is a this will lead to performance overheads and so on. So the easiest thing for us is like to say, okay, the buffer comes with its view, and you can get the different components of a buffer by using this get buffer component thing. And you get like the actual buffer, you get like a shader resource view, or you get like an unordered access view, which is basically means you can write it, you can write to it. And then you can, one of like these shader resource view, one of these properties is the size. So right now we have 2930 points. And then we need to compute how often, how frequently, how a compute shader has to be called, which I think is called like a dispatch count. And we are using on the fly, we are using this number. So little bit complicated. I think I did an illustration a while ago, but the idea is that so this thing is being called 64 times in parallel, like 64 cores on the GPU will do the same thing here, like one for like the first thing, one for the second thing, and so on. And after this is being completed, it will be done for the next batch, or the next thread group, I think it's called. And so these are the thread groups here. This is the compute shader stage that you need to access to define all these things. So it needs a compute shader, it needs to how often it should run, it wants all the buffers it wants to read data from, the buffers with views, and it wants the actual shader resource view to access, to read, and to write. And if you execute it, it will run this compute shader. Actually, you can do even things like you can overwrite this dispatch count and say you want to run it multiple times, which might be useful if you have like a simulation and want to re speed it up or so. You can do this there. But and then we have an operator here that takes basically makes sure that it returns a buffer, but first executes something. It's execute buffer update, it's called. So, and here we generate a new buffer, which includes all the points with our new position. Hui, this was a mouthful. And then we have our parameters, which are converted to buffer, and then they're passed into computer. Hui, this is complicated. If you have any questions, let me know. I'm not sure. I'm probably not a good person to explain this. But I think if you start using this thing, it's actually a really nice representation of what's going on with the compute shader stage. I think this is much more readable than writing this in code, no matter if it's C++ or C sharp. So let's do something with our shader code then. So maybe one thing we need more. We need more parameters. I think we don't need an amount, and we don't need a rotation and an offset. So let's just remove all these, and then we add a new symbol input parameter. So a parameter. Everything is strictly typed, which means before actually adding a parameter, it needs to know what type you want. And I want a size type. And I want it to name size, and I want it to be type of vector 3. So add it. Cancel. Then we duplicate this, split it into its component, and then we feed this to the shader. And inside the shader, the params are just float 3, position, float 3, size. And let's try if this works. So if we say after copying it to the target buffer, we take the position and we add it by the position parameter. Let's see. So if you move this here, we see that our shaders indeed does something with this parameter. So yay, we wrote our first compute shader and it's working flawlessly. And then what I thought we would do is maybe I will make a small sketch of what I had in mind. Or should I just do it? Sometimes I'm confused. What's faster, doing a sketch first or just doing something? So let's start Figma here. Let's go start design file. Let's open it. Figma, here we go. So the idea is we have points. Some random points. And then we want to basically take these points group and say they are repeated. So endlessly. Like a clone of points. Like an endless grid. And inside this let's turn scope on here and this maybe we don't fill it. We have like a grid. You can imagine like a grid of like the same repetition here. Duplicate. Ich you see that it's like cells that are being repeated. And then we can say, ah, we have a position here somewhere. Let's say we have a position. Here is our target position. This is our wrap size, this cell size here. And then I want around this target position, I want to see only these points. So I guess this is a perfect example of being imprecise. So let's take like this guy here. We don't want to fill it and stroke it bigger. So we want to center this around our target position, and then we want these points, or like these points that I this is the same as this, so we can't take it. So we don't want to add new points. We only want to make sure that these positions are wrapped inside this this area. I think it should be straightforward. So what we have to do there is to take a position, use a modulo function. So first, we don't do anything with the other values. We create a new value, float 3, new position. And this is the, we start with the source position. And here actually performance implication that this might matter. So it might be more efficient to only copy the structs without the position than changing copying. So, but even this, I wouldn't be sure like how the compiler optimizes this. So then we want to subtract this position with the position parameter, which would give us it should give us a position here, and maybe it's already enough to now use modulo with the this size thing. No, first be no. First we use this, we use the modulo, and then we add the position, and maybe we subtract half of the size. The weird thing about shader coding is you can test it live. So let's see what's happening here. So we wrap this. The size is 0, which would probably, so if we do something like this, so this is a modulo, this is the remainder of the division. So this is actually the division. If our size is 0, it's not going to work, obviously, because like all the versions will be look at this. That's a nice artifact. So we are using the source position and the erase position. Okay, so maybe don't regenerate this thing all the time, and maybe start with a simple buffer here. And we see that it's wrapping something. This also has an effect here. So the first thing is, let's see if we are So this is something strange. Let's not do this. We are getting the dimension of the source points. And actually this is a good question. I think we have, it should not be a problem. We are taking the position from the source points. And if we don't do the modulo, the size is, we first take the size. And the size is also position and size to the name. I think this is something horrible. So the problem is that like this float buffer needs alignment by form, which is like horrible. Because otherwise, I can't really explain why this is, but so there's something called padding, and I think there's a performance optimization called 16 byte padding or so. And so these together are only 12 byte long, and that's why there's like the small marker behind the 4 to explain that a vector starts at the right position. Oh, I'm horrible at explaining this. And then of course we need to have float one padding here. And then you can try this again. So if we change the size here, so if the size gets smaller, the block gets smaller, which is almost what we expected. And if we change the position, so the position I think should not, this should not make, let's create like a simpler solution. We can see how the patterns work. So let's generate like a small grid points with only one dimension. So and let's add a little bit of noise. Add noise. And maybe the noise is only, we only use the y-axis for the noise. So it's almost like a sine wave or so. That's our sine wave here. And I think this position. So what I have expected is that the sine wave, so let's first add the default value, that the sine wave should not change. It should stay in the same position, but only like the segment I see from the sine wave changes to the center. So hey, things good. Nice to see you. Why is the flickering? So the flickering, yeah, I expect this. This was basically because the input parameters were not padded correctly. So how we are doing horribly on the time. So I think I only have like maybe like 30 minutes left, but let's try to get this done. So the if we, this is math, I hate math. So maybe we can start by actually drawing this grid here. So let's add something, let's add an execute here and draw gizmo visible gizmos. And we draw our grid here. Oh, you want to evaluate this thing. And there should be something called like a grid plane. think it's like this script plane here. And we want to transform it to a correct position. And we want to like so. And then the size goes into the scale and the position goes into like a thing here. So and sometimes I like having like these gizmos. Oh, this was obviously wrong. The position goes into the translation and the size goes into the scale. What? What is this? So this also transforms this. Let's start with a quad mesh. We change the size here, change the size. Maybe like we, so this is like a small gizmo visualization of where we think the points should repeat. So this guy should actually be there and this should continue there. I think if the position is zero, it should be centered, which is just fine. And the size should be like so. Okay, if we change the position to negative, it should move to the negative, which is correct. So then I think these should be stay there, which is correct. And maybe we needed to subtract this. Position plus position. Okay, getting there. So just a little bit too big. If we change now the width here. Getting there, but not quite. Oh, creative coding. What is this? And then I guess the first, we also have to type of the size here. Subtract half of the size, so it's being wrapped on only one side. And if I modulo this here, I would have assumed that practically it should know the positions that, I'm so stupid, of course, stupid me, of course, we don't have to add it, we have to write it there. Okay, it's getting much closer now. Okay, now the, obviously the size, we don't need to half it. Now we, the modulo needs to, I think the problem here is that we do the modulo with a negative number, then it will flip here. So we must not use this thing here, but we must use a function called fmod. And I think it should be, we should have plenty of functions that use fmod. Let's take a function. Linear gradient. I think this one uses fmod. Let's see how this done. Fmod. This is what we want. This go away. Let's define this function here. Fmod. And then the. Okay, this is getting a little bit. So we have to later find a better. So, okay. An F mod for only once float. Separate is for. Okay. Yeah, getting there. Okay, it sounds crazy, but I think this is just the operator I wanted. So let's remove these. And yeah, so now we have this thing that, okay, I have a bunch of points and I want to contain them at a certain position. And I can change where this position basically is. And this might be super versatile to, so even if we take the points here and we modify it right now. Maybe we have like some random things here. So they will always be like contained within this one little container. And the great thing is that they can use, let's slow this down even further. We can use this to center the target position of this container to the camera. So we can do things like, let's say camera, and I think there should be something like camera position or so, cam position. And I think we can use the cam position. I guess it's so strange. But I think we can use the position. And now if I'm moving the camera, I always have points at my around my camera. And of course, I think they like this thing here is a direction, so we can actually take the other vector to, and we take the can take the direction, and maybe we can it should be possible to scale this vector. So now every time I move the camera, I have basically this point cloud in front of me, which might or might not be useful. Maybe we can, if we increase the size here, we could actually do something like particle effects or so, or like dust particles effect. So of course then this probably like a higher noise ratio or so. So they're also like always filling the space. But now we have an unlimited particle field, basically. And sometimes that might be useful, manchmal, sometimes not, I don't know. Let's see. Okay, but we made it. So we wrote a new operator. So I guess I will prepare a little bit better for the next live streaming. But on the other hand, it might be good to just watch how I code and how I add more features for tool. Maybe it would also be interesting to go into like having like a bug or so, picking a bug and trying to fix the bug together. So you get a feeling for the how the actual code base work. let's read the, or shall I say, not supported by them anymore. I wonder if the widgets would go the same way. The visual video segment editor, was it like, was this the video VSE? I think they're, if it's the video editor, I asked them the same thing and the team responded with no, definitely not, and they're working on it and having it very high on the agenda. So if you're talking about Blender, can you make an operator for it that has easy use parameters? You mean like this, like the thing having something in front of me that's always repeating? So to start with, so this size of the grid points should be the signs, they should be matched. So otherwise we will not have like the, so now it's infinite, otherwise we will have gaps, of course. Then, sure, so you can, you could basically do, you could take this guy here and wrap it into a new container. So this would be super straightforward and this would be points in front of you. But if you need that, I rather would say, so there is something called like a dust particles, which is basically this effect. Much better, much, it's much better because it already, so if we remove the points, so the, maybe we increase the size of the dust particle thing here. So this does this, you know, it already has a little bit of noise and it does things with, it has also things like you can add trails to it. So I don't know why this would be useful, but you actually can do this. Yeah, so if you want to, if you need this effect, use the dust particle effect. It's, I think it's just, it does just that, just a little bit cooler. And for me, the reason why I wanted to have like this prep points thing is sometimes you have, you want to have fill like a cluster of points with certain things, so not necessarily point to the camera, but so actually where was the cluster? So it might be, for instance, interesting to have like this grid point here. Let's get rid of these and have something like a loading animation. So you could, of course, take these and draw, maybe not, draw meshed points, cube mesh, before execute there, just plug it in there, let's make the cubes very small. So we first make a cube, and then if we, if, let's get rid of this noise and let maybe randomize our points and maybe only randomize them with at one axis, and maybe we also transform these points. So transform points. I think now we should have like an endless scroller here, you know, like a little bit like a data structure or something. And maybe we could also do this only in the, let's say we have like a city structure. So and the city structure should be, maybe we have a height here, like different sizes here. And now we can have something like, okay, like this, the structure is basically endlessly repeating, flying by. So let's have like a value, let's have like a scale vector 3. Let's use this as our grid size here and as our wrap size. Let's increase the size here. So like this is our city structure. Let's have much more points. Let's increase this further. And let's add some fog. So fog. Maybe don't need this gizmo anymore. And then you can see that there might be something there. So I'm not really sure where this would go, but you could now have instant, like this could scroll forever, but it would never run out of points. So this is actually the effect I wanted to build. And of course, this could go to like an oscillator two or something. Might be VGA effect or something like this. This you just made. Oh, nice, dust particles. Okay, I think, thanks for watching. Let's see where this is going in the future. Once in a while, it might be good to show you guys some part of code, and eventually maybe you will see that's actually really nice to write stuff and tool. So it might be intimidating for the first operator, but then it's actually really pleasing. At least I think so. Thanks for watching. I will switch this off. Maybe next time I will also figure out like why my camera didn't work. But the camera is working, but not in OBS. At least not in my streaming scene here. But we can fix this in the next time. Thanks for watching. Keep posting questions on Discord. I really enjoy discussing stuff there and listening what you like, what you find. What can be optimized and so on. So, yeah. Thanks a lot. Have a great weekend. Bye. Sure. Request. Okay, maybe I still have some time. I think so, at least. So what's the request? Can we have a cover audio syncing, please? Oh, sure, we can do this. I mean, until like my, so I still have some time. I can show you.